desert surrounding this circuit. It really is in the middle of nowhere, and around 20 kilometres, quite far really from the outside of Doha, considering the amount of desert we have to cross to actually get here. But certainly got big plans for Doha and big plans for the Lasalle International Circuit as well in the future. It's one of the fastest expanding economies in the world here in Qatar, and they're putting their money into sport. It hosts the Asian Games here next year, and I think for sport fans all around the world, it's got to be a good thing. Their football league is thriving as well. Some big stars coming over, and here today for the second time in the country's history, the world's premier riders and motorcycles will do battle on the Lasalle International Circuit.
As you can probably hear from my microphone, it's very, very windy down here on the front row of the grid, as it was for the 125s and the 250s. So you'd probably think that the MotoGP bikes are better suited than the other two, but it is windy. It's very, very hot indeed. Tire choice, I would imagine, not the greatest of problems. But what they're trying to do, I'm actually in front of Loris Capirossi's machine at the moment. They're really working hard to keep the bike and keep Loris Capirossi as cool as they possibly can.
That's one of the DeBoer brothers. I'm not quite sure which one. I think it's Ronald. There you go. Ronald DeBoer, Dutch football player. Twin brother, of course, to Frank DeBoer, who's actually moved back now from Qatar to coach at Ajax with his good friend Danny Blind. And Ronald DeBoer still out here plying his trade in Qatar. And as he was last year, coming to lend his support to Carlos Checa, who starts from the second row of the grid in sixth place. So the front row then, Loris Capirossi, we just got a glimpse of him before, on pole position. It's his third consecutive pole. It's the first time a rider has managed to set three straight poles for a non-Japanese manufacturer since John Kaczynski at the end of 1993 and the beginning of 94. And the man he beat to pole was this man, Sete Gibernau, but only just. It was something like 0.07 of a second, the difference between Loris Capirossi and Sete Gibernau at the end of qualifying yesterday. Carmelo Espoleta there, the CEO of Dorna, the rights holders to the World Championship, taking Qatari dignitaries on a tour of the MotoGP grid.
I'm with the dignitary now. Famous footballer Ronald de Boer, of course, playing here in Qatar. I think you enjoyed the race here last year, didn't you, Ronald?
Yeah. I was with Ruben Saus last year, but now we're with Carlos because he's also from Barcelona. He's a good friend of mine. So try to support him a bit, but he knows it much better than me.
Qatar, the sporting scene is amazing, isn't it?
It's what they're trying to achieve here. It's unbelievable. Every year they have new events, bigger events, and it's a country that's coming up a lot, and they love to do or to show the world that they love about sports. So it's great to be here, and also for me, like as a football player, it's a way of life, and you do your job, what you like to do is football. So it's a great way to end your career here.
And do you watch MotoGP when it's not in Qatar on the television?
Not so much. It's normally it's not really my kind of sport, but like every top sport, it's unbelievable what they have to like with so many horsepower under their sitting front. It's unbelievable to what they can do. So every top, I have so much respect for those guys. So it's tremendous.
Ronald, thank you very much indeed.
You're welcome. Take care,
Ronald. De Boer there, former Barcelona footballer, Dutch international, currently plying his trade out here with Al Rayyan, one of the leading football teams in the Qatar League. Marco Melandri still sipping on his grapefruit juice there on the second row of the grid. In front of him is Colin Edwards in fourth place. Good grid position for Colin Edwards, and looking to make up for that. Well, what he felt was a frustrating result last year in second place, 1.3 seconds behind the race winner, his teammate at the time, Sete Gibernau. A race he felt he could have won, and now he will charge from fourth on the grid to try and put that right. Marco Melandri then alongside him on the second row, and Carlos Checa here in sixth place. Checa actually started from pole position last year. He starts from the second row here.
I'm just going to have a quick word with Colin Edwards. He's taking a long drink. I think you're probably going to need a lot of fluid there, Colin.
Yeah, that might be an understatement, but just make sure you know you're hydrated. It's warm out here.
Very windy, isn't it?
Yeah, it's probably going to be a factor, I'd say, the first few laps. You know, don't get too crazy and just sort out, you know, where your brake markers are definitely going to change from yesterday. It feels a bit stronger than this morning, so just going to have to play around and sort it out.
I think you're very happy with qualifying, Colin, and you come into this race feeling pretty confident.
Yeah, it's good. You know, I mean, I had a good result here last year. Felt like I should have won last year, so we come here this year and want to win this year.
Keep drinking that drink, Colin, and good luck.
Yeah, you got it. Thanks.
Colin Edwards then talking to Nick Harris down on the grid. He's scored points in every race since Qatar last year. And while he's getting a drink, Tony Elias further back is he's not listening to his iPod, but he's certainly shuffling around nervously with it. It's his best grid position, Tony Elias, since the race in China earlier in the season when he qualified eighth fastest. But it's been a good weekend for the youngster so far. He was second in free practice on Thursday afternoon. He ended the day just behind Valentino Rossi on the combined timesheets. It was some performance from Elias. A little bit disappointed, I think, to be on the third row for this race, particularly after that performance in free practice on Thursday. But nevertheless, an excellent grid position for Elias, his first season in MotoGP, and getting stronger with that injured wrist as the races go by. He is lining up on the third row of the grid behind Shinya Nakano and Nicky Hayden. We move here onto the fourth row. Makoto Tomada, who, like Tony Elias, injured his wrist early in the season and has really struggled from then on. Wrist injuries for motorcycle races, the worst possible kind. And Tomada currently 10th on the grid and looking to end a disappointing season on a high. Same could be said for Kenny Roberts for lots of different reasons, but certainly Roberts has come strong at the end of the year. Certainly Suzuki have, and those Bridgestone tyres have as well, of course. But Roberts qualifying 11th fastest. He was 5th fastest in free practice on Friday morning. But again, like with at Sepang and Motegi, struggling a little bit with horsepower down the long straight here. And I think really for Roberts, particularly at this track, where at Sepang and Motegi, himself and John Hopkins were able to make up time on the lean angle with those new Bridgestone tyres through the corners. That's Suzuki's strength definitely in the moment, but with the extra sand on the track and the lack of grip here, they've really suffered to make the most of that advantage. Marc Genet down on the grid there, Ferrari test driver. How much work will he be doing with the Valentino Rossi next season? We wait to find out.
They're just making, just having a good chat, aren't they? Just making sure that they've swapped telephone numbers and just sorting things out for next year. We wait to see on that particular development, don't we? But that's going to be interesting. I think Valentino Rossi's probably got his mind on other things down here on the grid at the moment. As I said, this is a race he really, really wants to win. And you wouldn't bet against him doing that. But Colin Edwards, maybe spoke to him on the second row of the grid there. And I just got a feeling that Colin Edwards is going to be very close. I don't think he's going to have a better chance of winning a Grand Prix for a long time. He's had very good qualifying. Everything seems set for him. As he said, he should have perhaps won the race here last year. I think he's got a really big chance.
Max Biaggi struggling again. He's qualified 13th fastest. He starts from the fifth row of the grid. He was actually quicker yesterday on race tyres than he was on a qualifier. So again, Biaggi struggling with setup problems with that Honda. Likewise, his fellow Honda rider, Alex Barros, who qualified 14th fastest. That's Barros' worst grid since he was 16th at Phillip Island in 2003. And for both Biaggi and Barros, this is certainly not the time of the season when they want to be turning in performances like that.
No, and of course, Max Biaggi is still second in the championship, but he's coming under real pressure now from the informed Loris Caparossi, who's come from absolutely nowhere. But it is a very, very important time for these riders, and these four races, and starting with this one, are vital to their futures. And for Biaggi, certainly he'll want to hang on to second place in the championship, but it's going to be hard because Caparossi, I think, has come from eighth place before Bruno, second in Bruno, the win in Japan, the win in Malaysia, and he really has got a big chance of taking that runner-up spot in the championship away from Max Biaggi.
How things have changed in the space of a year for Ruben Schaus. He was third last year, finished on the podium, his only podium so far in MotoGP. Riding the Ducati last year, but he just hasn't clicked with that Yamaha this year. And well, we wait and find out what's going to happen to Ruben Schaus next year. There are a lot of rumours about him moving back to World Superbikes, but I think he said certainly in the build-up to this race he's got no chance of repeating that podium from last year. He starts from 16th on the grid. He starts behind Robbie Rolfo, who again, Nick, has been very, very impressive this weekend. And he's been impressive, in fact, over the last few races, hasn't he?
Certainly has. The machine isn't the top machine. It's a last year's Ducati motor, but he's riding with the Dunlop tyres, but he's done very well, and I think he's really established himself, which he wanted to do, Robbie Rolfo. He's the thinking man's racer, isn't he? He's really established himself as a MotoGP rider. That's what he wants, and now he's going to be looking for a better team to go to, but he's done well, as has James Ellison, who's actually behind him on the grid, also on the Dunlop tyres on that latter WCM. I think both of them, although they've been racing at the wrong end of the field, have impressed people. And you could see them, even as teammates next year, but certainly I think you're going to see them having a MotoGP future. They're the younger riders coming in, where we're talking about the Max Biaggis and the Alex Barros and a few others going out at the top end. Sometimes you've got to do that. It's very difficult for people back at home probably to think, they finished 16th, they finished 15th. That's really not a very good result. It's not bad on the machinery they've got, riding against the very, very best riders in the world. And the teams, the people that matter, watch this. And I know they're impressed by Robbie Rolfo, and they're also very impressed by James Ellison.
So the front row of the grid there, Valentino Rossi in third place, Sete Gibernau in second, and the man on pole for the third successive race is Loris Capirossi. Can he go on to take his third consecutive victory? Here they are, that front row once again. Rossi, the world champion, in third. Gibernau, the winner of last year's race, in second. Hasn't won a race since then. Loris Capirossi looking for a hat-trick of Grand Prix wins.
Just looking across to the grandstands here. Certainly there's a lot more, you can hear the wind now, but there's a lot more people here watching the race this year than there was last year. Interest growing in the Middle East, growing in Qatar for MotoGP. But that wind is going to be a mighty big problem for these riders.
The starting grid for the Marlborough Grand Prix of Qatar. Loris Capirossi from Gibernau and Rossi on the front row. Row two, Conan Edwards, Marco Melandri and Carlos Checa. Good performance from Shinya Nakano to qualify seventh fastest ahead of Nicky Hayden and Tony Elias on row three. Nakano, remember, the only Kawasaki rider out there this weekend now after the injury to Olivier Jacques. Makoto Tamada, Kenny Robertson, John Hopkins on row four. Hopkins unable to continue his run of front row starts. Row five, Max Biaggi and Alex Barros. Disappointing performances from them, but quite the opposite from Robbie Rolfo. He lines up alongside them on row five. Row six, Ruben Schaus, Shane Byrne riding that Camel Honda for the second time this weekend ahead of James Ellison. And then all on his own on row seven is Franco Battaini on that second WCM machine. Loris Capirossi waits to get the nod as he files off for the warm-up lap here. 22 laps to go of this LaSalle International Circuit, 5.38 kilometres in length. Just over 110 kilometres ahead of these riders. The fight for the championship is over. Valentino Rossi won it last weekend in Malaysia, but for the fight for second place is very much on. Just a quick reminder, Max Biaggi currently second by 17 points from Loris Capirossi. 3 points behind Capirossi lies Colin Edwards, and then Marco Melandri further 2 points behind Edwards, and just 3 points behind Melandri now is Nicky Hayden in sixth place. So all those riders with a very strong chance of overturning Max Biaggi and going after that coveted runner-up spot in the championship.
Back on the start and finish line, we wait for the gladiators to return from the desert. They won't be back for a little bit yet. And I got to say, as I keep telling you about the wind, it is as windy now as it has been in the 125 or the 250cc race. But great excitement on the start and finish line. And you're right, isn't it? It's the battle for second place in the championship. And can Valentino Rossi win the race he so desperately wants to win? The one that left such a bitter taste in his mouth when he left here in Qatar last year and went to Malaysia and then said that Sete Gibernau would never win another race. Can Loris Capirossi make it a unique hat-trick of wins for Ducati? There's a lot at stake in this race. The future of Grand Prix racing here in Qatar, I'm sure, is assured. But at the second place in the World Championship up for grabs, and a lot of riders riding out there for their MotoGP futures.
We ride here on board with Carlos Checa, the man who started the race from pole position last year. We talk about riders riding for the future. He's certainly doing a good job of that, isn't he, with that podium finish in Malaysia 6 days ago. Can he build on that here today from sixth on the grid?
All eyes crane away to the left from pit wall, waiting for the riders to come back into view. The safety car is there with the red lights flashing. The red flag is now being shown. The first riders make their way up this very long straight. It's over 1,000 meters long. A touch about, well, probably not today with this strong wind, but when the wind wasn't here, about 195 miles an hour over 300 kilometers an hour before braking for the second gear right-hander. But one would imagine the gearing has been ordered for the race this afternoon, because it's very, very windy indeed. Front row, the grid forms up in front of me. That famous yellow number 46 on the blue fairing of Valentino Rossi. In the middle, the man that won here last year and hasn't won a Grand Prix since. The blue fairing, the yellow numbers of Sete Gibernau. And the man in form, that red Ducati with the white numbers, number 65, Loris Caparossi, trying to give him and Ducati their third successive Grand Prix victory. The gentleman with the red flag steps away. The Qatar Grand Prix is about to get underway.
Caparossi gets away well from pole position. So does Valentino Rossi, also from the front row of the grid. Sete Gibernau comes up alongside him from second on the grid. They tip it into turn one. Caparossi, it seems, has the whole shot. Nicky Hayden doing well from the third row of the grid on the charge through. Oh, and he touches with Gibernau into turn one. Gibernau holds his line in there in second place. Hayden has to run it wide, but manages to bring it back round and looks to hold on now to third. Coming under pressure from Rossi. Looks as though Rossi has managed to squeeze through. Colin Edwards not getting the best of starts from the second row of the grid, but he's up there in that front group as well in sixth place. It's Caparossi from Gibernau, Rossi, Hayden, Melandri, Edwards, Checker, Robbie Rolfo, who's got an absolutely flying start from the back of the grid. And, well, look at this. He's challenging Carlos Checker now, Robbie Rolfo. What a ride from the Italian.
Must have been listening to what we were saying on the front row of the grid, mustn't he, when we were talking about him. Robbie Rolfo having a tremendous ride, but Loris Caparossi where he wants to be. Jim and I having to work hard, and I won't say not luck, unlucky to go down, but that was a bit of a coming together there with Nicky Hayden. There we are. Caparossi, Gibernau, Rossi, Hayden, Melandri, Edwards, Checker, Rolfo in eighth place, Max Biaggi in ninth. But Loris Caparossi chasing that unique hat-trick of wins for Ducati. He leads the way after half a lap.
Not sure how long this will last for Robbie Rolfo on those Dunlop tyres in these conditions, but certainly showing he's got plenty of ability here. Max Biaggi there running it a little bit wide as he tries to get past Shinya Nakano. He's going to close around the outside, is he, of Nakano? No, and he runs it onto the grass as he tries to do so. Oh, and it looks like Tony Elias has got through there ahead of Biaggi as well. So Biaggi there in his haste loses a couple of positions. Alex Barros not giving a good start either, and Shane Byrne not too far behind him.
It's Caparossi that leads the way into the right-hander that brings them back into the start and finish straight. Lap one almost completed. And as we've seen in the last 2 weeks, it's that red Ducati that leads the way with that big white number 65 at the front.
Loris Caparossi, winner of the last two rounds in Motegi and Malaysia. He leads the way from last year's winner at this circuit, Sete Gibernau. But for how long? Gibernau on the brakes into turn one, takes the lead. Can he hold it? It looks as though he can as they tip it left. He holds the inside into the left. Gibernau is through. Here comes Rossi, will take the inside as well. Up through on Loris Caparossi. Rossi forces his way through to second place. Caparossi now third. Hayden fourth. Melandri has given Edwards a hard time, but Edwards is through there ahead of the Italian for fifth.
Now, the battle commences. We haven't seen it.
Nicky Hayden gets past Loris Caparossi as well there. Sorry, Nick.
That's no problem at all, because Caparossi seemingly dropping back at the moment, but Rossi straight after Gibernau. Now he'll start those pressure games. The pressure is on Sete Gibernau. He has not won a race for a year. The last race win was here. And the man that he doesn't speak to, and he doesn't speak back to him either, Valentino Rossi, behind him. And Rossi will start exerting the pressure. Rossi's style, as we know. We ride with the world champion. The man leading the way, though, Sete Gibernau. And the man from pole position who got the whole shot, just dropping back off the pace a little bit, Loris Caparossi.
Robbie Rolfo's got past Carlos Checker there for seventh place, so he's continuing that incredible charge on last year's Ducati. There you can just see him. It's a slight gap back from Marco Melandri on that number 33 blue Telefonica Movistar Honda at the back of that front group. A slight gap around 1.1 seconds, and there's Robbie Rolfo, seventh place ahead of his factory colleague. Well, say factory colleague, of course, it's unfair really to suggest that Rolfo gets much factory support from Ducati. Carlos Checker certainly does.
He certainly does, and that's an incredible start by Rolfo. There he is, just got a glimpse of him then in that second group, but what a leading group it is. Now, don't forget, overtaking here is not easy. despite a lot of the sand coming off the track. It's been very, very windy here today, and riders will be very careful indeed. They come down the main straight once again, and Rossi is up the inside of Sete Givinau. Now, who's going to be bravest on the brake? Side by side, the great rivals, Marenba Jerez, that first race of the season. But this time it's Givinau that breaks slightly later for Valentino Rossi and hangs on to first place. And while those two scrap it out, Nicky Hayden in third place closes in on them.
Colin Edwards gets past Loris Capirossi as well for fourth place. So Edwards moving forward as Capirossi moves backwards. Valentino Rossi with the fastest lap of the race, 158.876. That is inside the circuit record here set by Colin Edwards last season. That was a 159.293 on the way to second place in the race. So it's a new circuit record despite these conditions here. Very, very windy here. Perhaps not as much sand on the track as there was last year. Grip during practice has certainly been a lot better, but these high winds here making life difficult for the MotoGP riders. It's made no difference to Givinau, Rossi and Hayden at the front. It's the three of them now battling for the lead. Edwards is closing in once again. Edwards doesn't make the best of starts to this race as he did at Qatar last year, but he's certainly better placed at this stage of the race than he was last year, and of course he went through to take second place in that race.
Yeah, not the best of starts, but you say a lot better start for Edwards than last year, and he's the man to watch out for. And he's comfortably in there at the moment in fourth place, tucked in behind Nicky Hayden. Rossi exerting that pressure on Givinau, but it'd be very interesting to try and find out or discover why Loris Capirossi, who went off the line like a scalded cat, just dropping back down a little bit. And that is surprising after those two successive wins.
But, well, you say that, Nick, but we're going to get a look at the start here. This is on board with Valentino Rossi, of course, his left clutch hand there, brake hand. And there, as you can see, I'm not quite sure why we're seeing this here, because I'm maybe thinking Robbie Rolfo, with the way that he started the line, maybe suggestion of some kind of jump start there, but certainly no sign of Rolfo there. But we're seeing Rossi now challenging Givinau for the lead once again. Just going back to the Loris Capirossi thing, Nick, as we see Colin Edwards set the fastest lap of the race so far, 158.345 for Colin Edwards as he closes in there in fourth place behind Nicky Hayden. But looking at the actual race times during practice, or the times that the riders set on race tyres, Loris Capirossi, despite setting that wonderful pole position time, his actual race pace was not that good. Capirossi setting times in the high 59s, and as we can see now, we're already getting close to the low 58s. And the only men really in that were Colin Edwards, who set mid 58s for much of the session, and Valentino Rossi, of course, who was in the mid-58s as well. Sete Givinau in the mid-58s. And Givinau good into the low-58s in warm-up this morning. So maybe a little bit surprising to see Capirossi go back so quickly from pole position, but certainly hasn't shown really over the course of the weekend that he's got the pace to go with the Hondas and the Yamahas.
Well, certainly the opening few laps would bear that out perfectly, wouldn't they? And these are the men that set those consistent laps during qualifying. They're the men at the front there. And there, Capirossi, look, it's got a slick hard front and a slick medium rear. So a hard front for Loris Capirossi. Now that could be perhaps one of the reasons. And this is Colin Edwards.
Marco Melandri giving Edwards a hard time
yes,
there.
Yes, he is. I'm surprised. I thought Edwards was clear from him, but certainly is. So Colin Edwards just settled into a good race rhythm, but Marco Melandri just ruffling him up just a little bit. But the fastest lap confirmation, Colin Edwards, a 158.343, third lap of three. Long, long way to go, but it's still Givinau that leads the way from Rossi, with Nicky Hayden in third place.
I would expect that lap time to be beaten here by Sete Givinau, Nick. Givinau's really got his head down. He's opened up 0.3 over Rossi over the last couple of sections, and he's now leading by 0.6. And Nicky Hayden is now putting the world champion under pressure as they come down into turn one. There you go, confirmation of that 158.224 from Sete Givinau. He does go faster than Colin Edwards on the previous lap. He's opened an advantage of 0.7 seconds over Rossi in second place.
Year ago, was it? It doesn't seem that long, doesn't it, that Sete Givinau was so delighted to win the race here, and Valentino Rossi really left in a strop, didn't he? But there we are, Sete Givinau, but we've seen it before, and Rossi seems to have this ability to phase him out at the front, put pressure on him, but Rossi in turn is coming under pressure from Nicky Hayden. Marco Melandri, another brave, brave ride by him with all those stitches in his heel. And Colin Edwards, the man that we quietly fancy perhaps to do very well indeed in this race, he's got to get past those Hondas in front of him.
Robbie Rolfo's having a magnificent race in ninth place. He's been passed by Carlos Checa and Shinya Nakano now, and he's coming under pressure from Max Biaggi and Tony Elias. And as I said before, with the lack of bikes out there on Dunlop tyres and the lack of investment that Dunlop are able to put into this MotoGP project, it's inevitable really that his tyres are going to degrade quicker than the other riders and he's going to start going backwards. But certainly over the first few laps, Rolfo has shown no shortage of talent to run up as high as seventh place. In fact, he's just been passed now by Max Biaggi for ninth. So Rolfo back down to 10th and probably going to be passed pretty shortly as well by Tony Elias.
All he can do is put himself in the shop window, and to ride the four or five laps like that really will make people sit up and take notice. A little wobble there from Valentino Rossi as he braked for the left-hander. And Rossi certainly not having it his own way. And Sete Gibbino is opening up an advantage at the front as they come round the right. That brings it back into the start and finish straight.
Hayden runs it wide. Hayden's very, very wide indeed. And Marco Melandri takes advantage. So Melandri comes through. It was through turn 16, that final turn, onto the brakes, into the right-hander. Hayden just overcooked it a little bit and left enough space for Melandri to come through. Now Colin Edwards will get his chance to put his compatriot under pressure into turn one. Not quite close enough there. The Texas Tornado on the Kentucky Kid as they brake for the right-hander. And here we ride with Hayden. There is Edwards lurking behind him, and their confirmation that Tony Elias there has got past Robbie Rolfo for ninth place. So Rolfo down to 10th, but still holding off the attentions of Makoto Tomada and Alex Barros.
It's Peter down the back end of the field, you wouldn't expect. John Hopkins 15th, Shaky Boom we see in 16th place. But the Suzuki's not having the easy of a weekend here, and obviously reflected in the timing and their results at the moment. But Gibbino really having a good ride at the front of Marco Melandri now, getting after Valentino Rossi. Of course, just 2 weeks ago, they had a controversial collision. It was opposite to this. It was Rossi chasing Melandri. This time it's Melandri chasing Rossi. They both went down. And Rossi, does he run it a little bit wide? Well, he pulls back across in front of Marco Melandri. But Melandri trying very, very hard indeed to get past Valentino Rossi and get after his teammate at the front.
Looks hungry, doesn't he, Marco Melandri, because Sete Gibbino is escaping at the front. It was 9/10 the gap, actually, as they crossed the line. But now it's just over 8/10. So Rossi and Melandri are closing in. And Melandri with the fastest lap of the race so far. Now 158.171 as they crossed the line on the previous lap. So that is a new lap record. Melandri's the man with the pace. He was marginally quicker than Gibbino at the front. Gibbino clocked a 158.196. And Melandri with that 158.171.
He really is after Valentino Rossi, wants to get past him. I think you're right, he's worried about his teammate getting away at the front. And Rossi's having to ride very, very hard indeed to hang in there in second place. But it's not easy to overtake here, as we keep explaining, because of the sand on the track and that racing line. But as they come down over the start and finish line, a perfect illustration from the helicopter shot, just how far Sete Gibbino has opened up the advantage. And you would say that Melandri is not close enough to Rossi this time to try and outbreak him into the right-hander. And Nicky Hayden still in fourth place, and Colin Edwards fifth. And you've got to say, it's between these five, as Loris Caparossi still dropping back just a little bit. We haven't come into shot yet. There he's just come into shot. But don't forget, he has got that hard front tyre that should start improving grip and adhesion as the race goes on.
Yeah, it's difficult tyre choice for all the riders out here, Nick, particularly because there are a couple of hard braking areas, particularly into turn 1 and turn 16. They've got to get a hard tyre to cope with that, and a hard tyre to cope with the heat as well that's coming up off the track, which is over 50 degrees at this time of the day. But also they've got to have it soft enough to get enough grip down as well, because the sand that's out there on the track is very, very slippery, of course. It's hard to get through that and get some grip down, so it's a real difficult compromise. Also with the setup of the bikes as well, to try and give them enough stability under brakes, but also enough feel to get through the sand and get some grip down onto the track. And the teams worked very, very hard over the course of the weekend with the tyre technicians, and those Bridgestone tyres that have been so, so good at Malaysia and Motegi, not quite as good here, certainly the race tyres anyway, as the Michelins.
Would it appear to be the case at the moment? And as you pointed out, it was the Michelins that were putting in those consistent laps during qualifying, if not actually qualifying in pole. And obviously the pole, the qualifying tyres of Bridgestone, very good for Loris Caparossi, but he's not in the hunt at the moment. But this is a tremendous race for second place. It's Marco Melandri, we can see as we ride with Valentino Rossi. But Melandri really hounding Rossi now. And Rossi not able to catch Gibbino at the front and exert that sort of pressure he's done on him all season. Round the right, into the start and finish once again. There's Rossi in second place, Melandri right behind him. Now, will the young Italian be close enough as they come down the start and finish straight 180, 185 miles an hour to pull out of the slipstream and try and outbreak him into the right-hander? He's certainly very, very close indeed. Here he comes out of the slipstream now on the brakes, but thinks, no, let's just leave it for another lap.
Perhaps realising that Rossi had actually closed down the gap a little bit to Gibernau there. So at the moment, Melandri, whilst wanting to get past Rossi and go after his teammate at the front, knows that Gibernau isn't actually making any more ground on Rossi than he had done previously. The gap still stands at 0.7 seconds. Valentino Rossi has set his fastest lap of the race so far, a 158.323, but still a couple of tenths short of that fastest lap set by Marco Melandri, 158.1. I don't think anybody really expected the pace to be that quick, although Gibernau did do a 57.9 in the warm-up this morning on race tyres, but of course that much cooler conditions at 11 o'clock, whatever it was this morning when the bikes went out for the warm-up. So in these afternoon conditions, it's much harder on the tyres, but having said that, it's still a big surprise for Marco Melandri to have done that 158.1. Gibernau doing a 58.1 as well, of course.
But certainly, I think Melandri, you're right, has just said, right, okay, if I'm getting pulled along and we're closing on Gibernau, I'm quite happy to stay there at the moment and wait to see when we get there. And there is Rossi in second place, Gibernau third, and he certainly hasn't had a dig at him, has he, for the last couple of laps, which he certainly had done previously.
Max Biaggi's difficult weekend looks to have ended, Nick. Max Biaggi just whizzing past me there in pit lane as I'm sat up here in the commentary box, and probably behind now, Loris Capirossi also in trouble. Capirossi running into the gravel. We ride on board here with the Ducati rider, and after the jubilation in the Ducati garage over the last couple of weekends with those double victories at Motegi and Sepang, it looks to be a much more disappointing weekend all round. And Max Biaggi, Capirossi's fellow Italian, let's have a look at it, wheeling across the line there, but it looks to be some kind of problem for Max Biaggi's Honda. And he is now back in his pit garage. So an early mission for you there, Nick, to get out in that sunshine and heat.
On my way.
Rossi continues to close down the gap to Sete Gibernau. And visibly, you can see it on the screen. Rossi has again improved on his fastest lap of the race so far, a 158.2 this time from Rossi. And now the gap between Gibernau and Rossi at the front stands at 0.4. So he's pulled three tenths of a second back over the last two laps. And he's just chipping away at that lead that Gibernau built up.
The thing about Max Biaggi dropping out of the race, isn't he, is that second place in the championship is disintegrating in front of his own eyes, isn't he? So that's a very, very big disappointment for Max Biaggi.
And a big opportunity for the men behind him in the championship. Loris Capirossi, I'm just looking down the timesheets now. It looks as though he's returned to the track in 12th place. But still 17 points behind Biaggi in the championship, so Loris Capirossi certainly won't catch Biaggi here, but he will close in. Colin Edwards, Marco Melandri, Nicky Hayden, all of them lapping in the top five here. Big chance for them to pull some points back on Capirossi in the championship.
I'm actually in the Repsolonga garage now, Matt, and disappear that could have been a throttle problem for Max Biaggi. I'm just trying to have a quick word with Irv Kanemoto and just see what, if Irv can just tell us what it is. Irv, just run away to actually look at the bike as it comes in, and it does appear that that could be the problem. We'll give you the news as soon as we can, but without a doubt, Max Biaggi, of course, is out of the race.
Marco Melandri now in third place. We ride with the former 250cc world champion. He's got his good old friend and former Minimoto rival in front of him. Valentino Rossi, certainly nothing mini about the motos they're riding here, of course. Rossi on the Yamaha M1, Melandri on that V5 Honda. They come down the straight here, third gear, fourth gear, fifth, up to sixth here. Melandri out of the slipstream of Rossi. We'll have a look into this first turn, but Rossi very, very strong on the brakes. They shift all the way back down the gearbox into second gear, around 100 kilometers as they come through this tight turn one, and they flick it left. Again, as I said before, very similar to Sepang, this first section of the track, tight right and then tight left. Then it goes out, stretches out into this long right, third up to fourth gear as they go through it, run 190, 200 kilometers an hour, and then back onto the brakes through this double apex right-hander. Second gear, 115 kilometers an hour through turns four and five.
Well, we're just watching the race here with Max Biaggi. Max, obviously very disappointing. What was the problem?
The bike stopped, there's electronic problem. Pop, 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 start to go. Stop and go, stop and go. It was
It was almost broken. I don't know what happened, but it's very strange. And
just interrupt Nick there.
Happened to Honda, to me. I don't know what to say.
Nick, we just have to interrupt the interview with Max.
Thanks,
Max. Valentino Rossi has run it wide and he's let Marco Melandri through to second place. So a problem there for Valentino Rossi. Great to hear from Max Biaggi explaining his problems in the race, but let's have a look at this. This might cheer Max Biaggi up.
I think actually we just saw a little smile then, just as he was obviously very disappointed indeed. Let's have a look at it again on the screen.
Yeah, just runs it wide and then, oh, John Hopkins in the pit lane as well there, Nick. So more work for you, I'm afraid. It looks as though Hopkins is going to go back out, but perhaps a rear tyre problem there for Hopkins. It looks as though they're going to change that rear tyre and try and get him back out on track.
Just walking down to Suzuki now, and it does appear that perhaps it is going to be a rear tyre change. There's frantic action going on, and right actually alongside John Hopkins' bike now. Let's just have a quick look. Well, yeah, they are changing the rear tyre now. That's exactly what they're doing. Yeah. All he can sit and wait and do is be patient until this is done.
Well, while all that was going on, Nicky Hayden set the fastest lap of the race so far with a 157.9, the first and only rider to dip into the 157s in this race so far. It's pulled him right back into contention for this podium and perhaps even victory here. Let's keep an eye on Hayden's progress. 58.3 on that lap from Hayden, still 0.4 quicker than the man in front of him, Valentino Rossi, and quicker, in fact, than the man who's leading the race, Sete Gibernau. So Hayden making up ground here in fourth place. Well, the conditions not suited to many of the riders out here, with it being so slippery. Lots of dirt on the track, but nobody out there is better than riding with dirt on the track than the former dirt track AMA champion, of course, Nicky Hayden, currently in fourth place and reveling in the conditions out there, it seems. Even though he struggled to eighth on the grid, he's certainly one to watch when these tyres go off, and it's going to be pretty soon. We're approaching the halfway stage of the race here. We're on lap 10 of 22, and those tyres are going to be starting to go off pretty quick in those intense hot conditions down on the track. And Hayden, it seems, getting more and more comfortable as this race goes on. So Marco Melandri then up to second place. What can he do with Valentino Rossi out of his way? Riding, remember, still with 35 stitches in his right foot. It's quite incredible, really, and they had to adjust his bike in Malaysia last week because he wasn't able to hit the rear brake quite as hard as he normally would do and not put enough force down. He's able to put a little bit more force down on it this weekend, but he was still in a lot of pain during practice. And it was during practice, actually, that he was able to take his right boot off. Every time he came in and the mechanics worked on his bike, Melandri took his boot off and put it in the freezer to try and keep it cool. Otherwise, his wound was burning up. Now he's been passed by Valentino Rossi here down the straight. 11 laps to go, the halfway stage of the race. And after that mistake, Rossi is back through for second place. Sete Gibernau has increased his advantage again at the front of the pack. 0.8 seconds now he leads from Valentino Rossi. 58.079 from Gibernau on that last lap. Not quite as quick as Nicky Hayden's lap record here. A 57.9, two laps ago from Hayden. And on this lap, Hayden just losing a couple of tenths, in fact, to Gibernau and to Rossi.
Just confirmation, Matt, that it was a rear tyre, John Hopkins, and it was the rear tyre they have changed. So Hopkins back in the race.
John Hopkins, who will return to this race in last place. There's 18 riders still out there. Marco Melandri still battling here with Valentino Rossi. This is a pass Rossi made, clean as you like, straight down the front straight there, out of the slipstream and into second place. But Melandri again looking to get around the world champion. Melandri closing in on Rossi once again. This the fight for second place. Gibernau clear at the front. Nicky Hayden there in fourth. Further back, Colin Edwards is now 2.6 seconds down on Nicky Hayden in fifth place. A further 10 seconds back, Carlos Checa in sixth from Shinya Nakano, Tony Elias, Alex Barros, Kenny Roberts, Robbie Rolfo, Loris Capirossi, Makoto Tamada, Shane Byrne and Ruben Schaus. They make up the points at the moment. Further behind Schaus is James Ellison and Franco Battaglini, the two WCM riders. And then now, currently back in last place after that rear tyre change, John Hopkins.
Still the battle rages for second place, doesn't it, between Rossi and Melandri. And Melandri, you so rightly say, what a brave ride by him. And they were worried about infection with the heel if it was a little bit hot when he was out there riding. It certainly is hot there again. He just pulls out of the slipstream once again, thinks about going up the inside of Valentino Rossi, but he's a little bit wary of this right-hander after the start and finish straight and just stays on the racing line. And in the meantime, Nicky Hayden just making a little bit of progress in fourth place and probably just fancying his chances of a nibble of a podium finish.
Just dropped off a little bit there, Nicky Hayden. 58.6 on the last lap. 7 tenths slower than that fastest lap. Don't know where he pulled that lap from, that 57.9. It pulled him in briefly to the top, towards the top three. But again, he's just dropped off again in the periphery of the action. Once again, Nicky Hayden in fourth place. Giovinazzi controlling this advantage at the front over Valentino Rossi. Currently stands at around a second. It was 1.1 as they crossed the line. It's 9 tenths now. Let's have a look through the third split. So Rossi just takes a fraction of a second back out of Giovinazzi, but again, not enough to make an impression. Giovinazzi has rode very, very impressively indeed. He's been on rails almost at the front there. And well, Nick, you said at the start of this race that Valentino Rossi's got plenty of motivation to win this race here. He wants to take 10 wins for Yamaha. It would be the first Yamaha rider ever to do that in the Premier class. He wants to end a drought almost in his terms. Certainly since he became a Yamaha rider, he's never gone three races without winning a race before, but that could happen today if Giovinazzi can hold this out. And of course, the one thing he really wants to stop is Seta Giovinazzi from winning a race 1 year on from the day that Rossi said he would never win another one for the rest of his career.
How long does a gypsy's curse take? I mean, is it just a year, the gypsy's curse, and then does it come off? Because if it is, he's just about right, isn't he? We'll see if we can find a lady out in the desert in a caravan and go and ask her, but perhaps the curse is gone. Perhaps this is just what Seta Giovinazzi needed, but he is riding a brilliant race at the front, and it's Marco Melandri, of course, his teammate, that's putting real pressure on Rossi. There's Melandri third, Nicky Hayden in fourth place, and got to say, a bit disappointed with Colin Edwards, because I really did think he had a chance perhaps of winning this race, but no. Giovinazzi, well, this could be the resurgence of Seta Giovinazzi just a year after that last Grand Prix victory. A little bit of a wobble then, tyres really going off now in the heat and the dust and the sand.
I think for Colin Edwards, Nick, as much as anything, he would have looked at the lap times yesterday evening, seeing the mid-58s that looked to be the race pace here, and thought that he was well capable of doing that. But he's been caught out here by the pace of Giovinazzi at the front. And the only men able to go with Giovinazzi in the race today have been Rossi, Melandri and Hayden. It's been an electric pace right from the start from Giovinazzi. Low 58s all the way. Edwards managed to stay in touch over the opening few laps, but since then he's just dropped off. And as I said, the only three men able to stick with Giovinazzi have been Rossi, Melandri and Hayden. And it's really more to their credit than against anybody else that there's only four riders left with a chance of winning this race.
Yeah, it's the pace they've set, isn't it? There's no other reasons for it. The pace they've set is just too fast for anybody else. And it was a pace that I think nobody expected in these conditions. We ride with Marco Melandri, the man in front of him, the world champion Valentino Rossi. They've been at it throughout the race almost. But Rossi ran it wide once, but he's now got back into second place. Melandri's still behind him. Giovinazzi setting an electric pace at the front. And Nicky Hayden working very, very hard indeed. I think he's just on the peripheral, isn't he, of that podium finish. It's another work hard to catch these two at the front. And all the time, they're taking more and more rubber off those tyres and taking more and more physical exertion. It's hot, very, very hard out there indeed. That 14 and 22 over the start and finish line. Melandri again in the slipstream of Valentino Rossi. Once again, elects to stay there, not to pull out and try and outbreak it into this right-hander. I won't say that he's settled, that he's not going to catch it Giovinazzi at the front, but he certainly does seem settled that he's going to wait behind Rossi for a little bit longer. We ride on board with Carlos Checa.
You can see there on the bottom left of the screen, Nick, the temperature gauge for the rider's suit. Checa in Alpine Stars leathers. And all the Alpine Stars riders here, you may have noticed on the grid, actually, they all had a fan attached to their back. It almost looked like a jetpack that they were wearing on the grid there. But all the Alpine Stars riders have got a special back protector in with a cooling strip down the back. When they come in for practice, they've got special seats to sit in as well that cools down that strip in the back protector, and then on the grid they have the special fan at the top as well to keep it cool while they're sat on the grid. Of course, what they can't control is how cool they stay out on the track, and as you can see, the temperature's rising. Carlos Checa's suit there, 30 degrees, and sure, that's to get warmer as this race goes on.
No, I haven't got a timing screen. You have on down on pit lane, but it does appear to me that Rossi and Melandri, without any shadow of a doubt, are starting to close in a bit on Sete Giovinazzi.
Well, Melandri's pushing hard. He set a 1:58 dead on the last lap. That's his fastest of the race so far. Giovinazzi still in the mid to low 1:58s. So Melandri and Rossi are definitely closing in. I'm looking now as they come through the third split. They close down 0.2 seconds through the first two sections, but Giovinazzi pulled that back out through section three. So the gap still stands at 0.6 as they come through the third section. Now it'd be interesting to watch Marco Melandri here through section four. He says this is his favourite part of the track, actually. He's just come through section four. Now they're coming to the final bend. So we don't get to look at Marco Melandri there, but it would be interesting to see if Rossi and Melandri have pulled anything back on Giovinazzi through that final section as they cross the line. There they go, 0.4 the gap, so they have pulled back 0.2 seconds on Giovinazzi. So it seems as though Rossi and Melandri have a slight advantage over Giovinazzi through the first two sections. Giovinazzi was able to pull it back through section three, which is over the top into that tight left-hander, and then through the series of fast rights and into the final two turns, the left and the right, Melandri and Rossi have an advantage over the Spaniard.
A little wobble there from Valentino Rossi on the Yamaha in second place, but he holds firm, holds on that racing line. And just starting to exert a little bit of pressure on Giovinazzi at the front, and as we've seen throughout this season, when the pressure has been exerted, and certainly by Valentino Rossi, he has cracked on many occasions. Will he crack this time in the heat and the humidity? Well, not humidity, just the heat and wind of Qatar. They are closing. You're absolutely right, Matt. This is the section where they're very, very quick indeed. But then Giovinazzi on that third section just seems to be the pullout, or just keep the advantage to his advantage.
Yeah, and you know, precisely to that law, Nick, Giovinazzi pulls out 0.2 seconds. Loses 0.1 seconds through the first section. Rossi and Melandri pull out 0.2 on him in the second section. The gap now 0.3. This is as close as it's been probably all race, really, for Rossi and Melandri hunting down the race leader Sete Giovinazzi. It'll be interesting to see now through sections three and four. This is where Rossi and Melandri have had the advantage over Giovinazzi over the past couple of laps. It's through this fast series of right-handers. It's a triple right-hander. It's the only triple right-hander on the entire calendar. And Melandri said after last year's race, this was his favourite part of the circuit. Certainly bearing true in the race here. 0.3 was the gap. Now they come down to the final turn. It's the second gear right-hander, 10 kilometres perhaps, second gear through there into turn 16 and down this straight here. And now he's been told, as you can see, Sete Giovinazzi, lap 6, 0.3. Two men behind him, it's Rossi and Melandri. And here now, Rossi comes up right alongside Sete Giovinazzi and just shows the first sign to Giovinazzi of that big yellow number 46. How many times have we seen him do that down the years? How is Giovinazzi going to react?
That is Valentino Rossi against Sete Giovinazzi, isn't it? That's exactly what he does. Just show him that number 46 and see if he can hang on to the pressure. He hasn't done so far this season. Can he do it this time? But meantime, Marco Melandri now almost desperately get the feeling to get past Valentino Rossi, and he's done it. He's got up the inside of Valentino Rossi, and Marco Melandri, as he run it wide? No, and he hangs on to second place. Oh, and Rossi almost clips the back wheel there of Marco Melandri. He in turn runs it wide, and Nicky Hayden may have just sneaked through to third place. Not quite. That was a mistake by Rossi. He almost clipped the rear wheel there of Marco Melandri. Now, that would have been controversial after the problems we had in Japan, but Melandri now in second place and after his teammate.
Payback from Melandri to Rossi from Motegi 2 weeks ago. Here you have it up on the inside. Melandri just runs it a little bit wide. Rossi tries to pull the line back, and look how Melandri shuts the door on him.
Remember Motegi, he's written on his letters, I think, as he went through there. But yeah, Rossi can't complain, can he, after Motegi? But Melandri really means business. Don't forget, he hasn't won a MotoGP race. This could be his very, very best opportunity. And Rossi's got a lot of hard work to do. He's got Nicky Hayden behind him. They're quite happy at Telefonica Movistar.
They enjoyed that, didn't they?
They did. They liked that moment indeed. Now, are Yamaha going to protest at the end of the race?
I wouldn't think so. Here's Marco Melandri now in second place, absolutely flying at the moment. 0.2 separate him from his teammate, Sete Giovinazzi. Certainly no team orders out there. Neither of these riders, of course, with a chance of winning anything other than the runner-up spot in the World Championship this year. And Melandri, he's firmly got his teeth stuck into his teammate here, almost literally, hasn't he, as they come flying down the straight once again. Five laps to go. Has Valentino Rossi's chance of winning this race gone? Marco Melandri shut the door on him, forced him wide. Rossi did well to actually stay on the bike, but Melandri is hungry. He's desperate for this first MotoGP win, and he was so, so determined that it was not going to be Valentino Rossi that stopped him. There's the gap, 1.2 seconds. That's how much it cost Valentino Rossi. And what we talk about determination, he's got it in bags, and he's already closed that down to 0.8 through the first section. I can tell you, Rossi is already closing in on Marco Melandri. We may not have seen the last of the world champion in this race. 4.5 laps to go, and here comes Melandri for the first time, challenges for the lead. Let's Chibinau know he's there, runs it wide on the exit. Rossi closes in as well. That just helps Valentino Rossi pull back in a couple of crucial meters. And Melandri takes his gloves off and says, come on, Sete, let's go for it now. 4.5 laps to go. And this is handbags now. Melandri through on Chibinau, runs it wide and back down to second place. Let's have another look. Never really looked tidy enough, did he, to hold his line through the corner. But I'm sure that's not the last crack that Marco Melandri's going to have. And well, here comes the second one. This time it's smoother. Again, he runs it wide. But is he going to hold his line as he did to Valentino Rossi? Chibinau tries. Oh, and Chibinau runs it into the gravel. The man who's cracked once again is Sete Chibinau. Marco Melandri this time put the pressure on him. And I'm sure that both Melandri and Rossi are smiling under their visors here in Qatar.
They cannot believe it in the Telefonica Movistar Honda pit. Well, one half, I won't say, is pleased, but obviously they've still got their man out there. But Valentino Rossi now closing. I won't say for an inevitable victory, but Valentino Rossi is just panning out beautifully for him. He's going to put a lot of pressure on Marco Melandri. They're side by side as they go past me down the start and finish straight. Is he close enough on the brakes? Valentino Rossi, not quite. And don't rule out Nicky Hayden there in third place. He's let all the fun and games go on in front of him, and he's riding a very good race indeed. But the gypsy's curse continues for Sete Chibinau. Can you believe it?
He's back on track. He's in fifth place. He's got Colin Edwards 2.3 seconds ahead of him. If he can try and close down that, it's damage limitation really for Sete Chibinau, who was challenging for the lead until this. He holds his line here on the inside, perhaps trying a little bit too hard to push Marco Melandri wide. And as Marco Melandri backed off here, Chibinau ran it straight into the gravel. And to be fair, I really don't think Chibinau can blame that on anybody but himself once again.
Yeah, he did well to hang onto the bike, didn't he, and get back into the race in fifth place. But what an extraordinary season it has been for Sete Chibinau. It really is difficult to believe. But now the race at the front between the two Italians. Marco Melandri, of course, former 250cc world champion. Valentino Rossi, a former 250cc world champion. When it comes into MotoGP, when it comes into 500cc, Rossi holds that big advantage. Melandri chasing his first ever Grand Prix victory, and Rossi desperate to win this race after the problems he had last year.
As I mentioned before, Nick, Melandri had problems with that foot more than anything with the heat in Malaysia, because of course he's had, as I said before, 35 stitches in the sole of his foot, which you can imagine is painful enough anyway, but you imagine how sensitive the area around that is. And that was the main problem for Melandri. It was the heat caused around the area of the injury that was the worst. And it looks like there's a rider gone down in the gravel there in the background. Nick, the marshals were trudging across. I'm not quite sure.
It's a long trudge as well, isn't it, through those gravel traps? But it must have been somebody a fair amount down the field because of these are the riders going through.
I think it might have been Ruben Schaus, Nick. We're just looking out. I haven't seen Ruben Schaus come up on the timing screens yet. Oh, in fact, there goes Schaus. So he is still in the race. So it's not Ruben Schaus. Anyway, here comes Valentino Rossi once again, putting the pressure on Marco Melandri. We've seen him do this so many times in his career, to Max Biaggi and to Sete Chibinau, and now to Marco Melandri. Here is Chibinau. He crosses the line down in fifth place. He's still some way adrift of Colin Edwards. In fact, he's losing ground on Colin Edwards. He's lost 1.5 seconds on that last lap to the American. So it seems Chibinau is resigned to fifth place. Colin Edwards currently lapping alone in fourth. And there's the battle for the lead between Melandri and Rossi. Nicky Hayden just hanging on to the back of it, but certainly seems with 2.5 laps to go, just over 2 laps to go, in fact, that he's not going to be close enough to challenge either of these riders at the front.
What's so good about this championship is it's a different rider challenging Valentino Rossi almost every race. It's been Loris Caparossi, now it's Marco Melandri. Melandri so close to winning his first ever MotoGP race. And he's riding very hard at the front. And Rossi, though, you just know, is going to have one really big go at him. And well done, Nicky Hayden. He's ridden a brilliant race in third place. We haven't mentioned him much, and that's always a very, very good sign, isn't it? What a steady, good race he's ridden there in third place. That's the championship position, so Melandri would move into second place in front of Max Biaggi. And Colin Edwards would close pretty hard also on Biaggi. Biaggi out of the race. He said the bike just stop, start, and probably an electrical problem.
Marco Melandri, who finished in the top four positions for the opening seven rounds of the season. He finished fifth in Malaysia last week. That was his first top five in the last six rounds. And it just all looked, once in Motegi when he crashed out, it seemed that brilliant charge he'd done in the first half of the season to hang on to second place in the championship. It looked as though it had all turned to dust. And with Max Biaggi coming through to finish on the podium there, it just seemed as though it was all set up for Max Biaggi to take second in the championship. But what a fight back this has been from Marco Melandri in the championship and in the race. Here he is, side by side with the world champion. Rossi round the outside, onto the brakes he goes. Rossi takes the lead once more into turn one. Two laps to go. Two Italians once again do battle for MotoGP victory. This time it's in Qatar. This time it's Marco Melandri carrying the charge to Valentino Rossi.
What can Melandri do to fight back? He's hanging in there at the moment. Rossi that time ran the outside as they break for the right-hander at the end of the start and finish straight. He'd try and break Melandri now, but Melandri is hanging in there very, very well indeed. This is going to be a fabulous last, what, 2.5 laps here in Qatar. What a race we've seen again. But Valentino Rossi, the man who left here with such a bitter taste in his mouth last year after crashing out of the race, leads the way. But Marco Melandri giving him a real hard time.
Crucial lap for Marco Melandri, no doubt about it, Nick. I think you're absolutely right. Rossi's going to try and break him now. How many times have we seen him do this, put pressure on, and then just take the lead on the last couple of laps and extend it? He did it to Sete Gibernau at Le Mans earlier in the season. And, oh, Marco Melandri in all sorts of shapes there as he tried desperately to stay in touch with Rossi. He's doing a good job of it so far, and surely he's going to have a nibble. Once again, they come through that long, long left-hander up to third, fourth, fifth gear, and then all the way back down the gearbox into second. Again, this is Melandri's favourite section of the track, set from corner 12 to corner 16. This is 12, 13. We're coming up towards turn 14 now. Another right-hander. And then on the gas, and then down to this third gear left-hander, turn 15. Melandri is close. Is he going to be close enough to make an attack to Rossi, either into this final corner or into the first corner of the final lap?
We look away to our left on pit lane, and here they come.
Melandri getting good
very
drive there.
Nice and close indeed. We ride with Marco Melandri now. That's Valentino Rossi in front of him. Rossi went around the outside of him and outbraked him. What is Melandri going to do? He's going to try and go up the inside of Valentino Rossi. They're not quite close enough. No, Rossi very, very late on the brakes and hangs on to the advantage.
That could be the crucial moment in this Grand Prix. Valentino Rossi holds off the challenge of Marco Melandri into turn one. One lap to go. They go right, then they go left. Then it's right again. Third gear, 190 kilometres an hour through turn three. Charging up towards this double apex right. An opportunity for Melandri here if he can get close enough. He can't quite. Through the first part of the turn and through this second right-hander, turn five, and then down here to a tight left. Here will be a chance now for Marco Melandri. He has a look around the outside of Valentino Rossi. Will he try and get the drive on the exit here up through this fast left? Takes a slightly tighter line, gets on the power. But again, Rossi is so, so strong. Here comes Melandri again through this turn 12. So I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit through there, through turn seven, the right-hander. Down through this sweeping section that will bring them down to another tight left-hander. Melandri
certainly
is close
enough, isn't he, Matt? I'm on pit wall right in front of Valentino Rossi's pit, but he certainly is close enough, Marco Melandri. Well, I'm sure he's going to have one more go. Is this going to be it?
He's getting right up alongside Valentino Rossi. Here comes Melandri. Can he hold his line? No, he runs it wide. He's going to go into the grass.
It's finished. All over.
Well, I just wonder, Nick, if Melandri might leave it till the end to try and draft Rossi, as we've seen in the 125 and 250 races. He's tried to have a bite earlier, and now, as you rightly say, it's all over. Valentino Rossi is going to be back on top of the winner's rostrum here in Qatar. And it's payback time for Rossi after that crash last season. His worst race of 2004 is now a distant memory. This could be one of his best of 2005. Valentino Rossi wins the Qatar Grand Prix. A brave but ultimately futile attempt to clinch victory from Marco Melandri as he crosses the line in a nevertheless excellent second place, and the podium completed by Nicky Hayden.
What a fabulous race, though. Well done, Marco Melandri. You gave it absolutely everything to try and beat Valentino Rossi. But as so many people have found out this year, it's very, very difficult to do that. But that was just a fabulous race.
And what about this man? Sete Giovinazzi led the race for so, so long. He built up a good lead at the front. He held the advantage. He was reeled in by Rossi and Melandri. And then as soon as Melandri started to put him under pressure, he cracked once again, ran it wide into the gravel, managed to bring it back, and he's done well to cross the line in fifth place. But Sete Giovinazzi will see that as perhaps his last chance to win a race in 2005, slipped away out of his grasp once again. And who is there to pick up the pieces once more? Who else but Valentino Rossi?
I'm with Jerry Burgess now. It just never ceases to amaze you, does he, Jerry?
It was a great race. I mean, in many ways, the pressure's off us a bit, but it was great to see Marco up there, and it was just probably one of the really good races. Nicky was quite close, and we lost a bit of ground at one time and caught it back up, and everybody had their little dramas, and we were able to come out on the last lap and win it.
He really wanted to win this one, didn't he, after last year?
Oh, I think there was a bit there from last year, sure, but we like to win every one.
What's so good about the championship, Jerry, is that it's a different challenger almost every race, isn't it? That's what makes it so exciting.
Well, that's great for the future. You know, if we can get some more young guys in there, we're going to see some wonderful racing in the years to come.
See you in Phillip Island.
Will do, Nick.
Jeremy Burgess there, Valentino Rossi's crew chief, talking to Nick Harris down in pit lane. Nicky Hayden there, confirmation of that lap record, 157.903 on lap 9 from Hayden. Back on the podium as well. Good result for him after that victory at Laguna Seca, of course. He took third place at the Sachsen Ring as well. But three races without a podium for Hayden. And now he closes right in on that battle for second in the championship as well. Big slaps between Rossi and Marco Melandri. All of the friendly variety as well. Rossi knows just what a performance that was from the youngster. And as Jeremy Burgess rightly says, some real hope for the future with that performance, not just from Melandri, but also from Hayden. We've seen bright stars in the 250 race as well, in the shape of Casey Stoner and Jorge Lorenzo. And, well, question marks about the future of MotoGP and the future of Valentino Rossi, certainly, but certainly no doubts about the race action that we will be promised in the years to come. Melandri, absolutely incredible today, with 35 stitches in his foot, and the only man capable of putting up a challenge to Valentino Rossi. Rossi bows, takes the plaudits, his 10th victory of the season. And Nick, down in there, in and amongst.
In the wind, in amongst the people, enjoying every moment of it. That was a great MotoGP race. And you could see by Jeremy Burgess's face just how much they enjoyed that race. Hey, they like winning, but that was what MotoGP was all about. And that's why, without a doubt, it is the premier motorsport event in the world.
Just watching the replay there of Melandri's pass on Rossi on the final lap when he ran it wide. He just ran out of track, didn't he? And it's a real characteristic of this circuit, which Rossi found out to his cost last year, that it's quite narrow, especially on the exit from the turns. And if you do run it wide, then you're in trouble. And we saw it with Sete Giovinazzi as well in this race. You just wonder if the track was a little bit wider or if there was a bit more rumble strip there that Marco Melandri might have been able to keep his pace into the next turn. And once again, Giovinazzi's assistant there, Edu, is left with probably the hardest job in the paddock right now.
Must say that, but you've got to say, Matt, and it's sad to say, Sete Giovinazzi cracked again under the pressure there for his own teammate. From anybody else, that's exactly what he did, and there you go. There was absolutely nothing he could do. Valentino Rossi just runs past me. I think you can probably hear that they're pretty happy with that victory, and he's still got his crashing helmet on, but they are absolutely delighted. And as Jerry Burgess said, just a little bit more motivation perhaps for this one than there has been for previous ones. Nicky Hayden is really pleased as well. I'll try and get a word with Nicky Hayden in a minute, but he is absolutely absolutely delighted. And Marco Melandri, his team are all around him. He's done a brilliant job, and he really has pushed Valentino Rossi to the limit this afternoon, and that's fantastic. Valentino Rossi right in front, you can't speak to him, he's still got his helmet on. He is really, really chuffed is the word, I think, really chuffed. Davide Brivio, the Yamaha team manager here, that was a great race, wasn't it? Not only for Yamaha, but for MotoGP.
Yeah, a great race. Another win from Rossi, but as I already say, every time is different, and every time is a different way. And this was going to be very hard, because when Sete took 1.2, it was probably the maximum gap we had this season, probably on Sete on a race, I don't know. But anyway, then kept going, and unbelievable. I mean, everybody saw the show, and I think it's worth the ticket.
He really wanted to win this one, didn't he?
Yeah, but he wanted to win this as every race. Of course, here is something special after last year, so we never win in Qatar, but the willing to win is the same for every Sunday. So today's Saturday, but he wanted as well.
I think I'm with you, David. I think we'll buy a ticket for Phillip Island if the racing continues like that.
Yeah, you should buy a ticket for all circuits, and something different happen every time. So that's the good of MotoGP.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Ciao, bye.
Well, there you go, you heard it first. If you're down in Australia watching this, Gowa's Yamaha team director there, Davide Brivio, giving you his version of it. Get a ticket, we'll be there in 2 weeks' time. And as Nick rightly says, if the racing is anything like it was today in Qatar, then we're definitely in for a treat. 1.6 seconds in the end, the winning margin for Valentino Rossi over Marco Melandri, but that certainly doesn't tell the whole story.
Anyway, sorry to butt in, Matt, I've got Nicky Hayden with me now. Nicky, that was a fabulous third place, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. It was really tough. I mean, I went faster than I qualified, and you know, before the race, I mean, I didn't just want to ride around in fifth, and this morning I struggled, and I just had to go for it in the race, and a few times I didn't know if I was going to make it home. I was pushing the front a lot, but I hung in there as long as I could and went way faster than I've went all weekend. But congratulations to Valentino, he got another one, and just thanks to my team for working really hard and believing in me and, you know, giving me a good package today.
Nicky, thank you very much indeed.
All right, thank you.
Nicky Hayden there, who finished third today. As Nick said, a fabulous podium from his point of view. And when you look at the championship that we just did there while Nicky was talking, just 11 points now separate second from sixth place. And it's just switched around once again. We saw Loris Capirossi come storming through to third in the championship with those two straight wins. Looks as though he was on course to finish runner-up. But Capirossi has now dropped to sixth. And Nicky Hayden himself is within 9 points of his teammate Max Biaggi in second place. So Nicky Hayden could even finish runner-up in this World Championship.
Yeah, that's what it's all about. And I think talking to David Brivio, talking to Jerry Burgess, everybody said just what a great championship it is. And this is just so, so good. And each race, a different challenger comes along to Valentino Rossi. Loris Capirossi is the man that's actually beaten him on a couple of occasions. But Marco Melandri, who's just talking out to the Italian press, he just gave it absolutely everything. It just went a little bit wrong on that last lap, but what potential this lad has since he's come to Honda, and it's going to be a big, big challenger in the years to come.
Yeah, he had a difficult spell in recent weeks, as we said, finishing the top four for the opening seven rounds of the season, right up to Assen when he finished second. And then he had that crash on the first lap at Laguna Seca coming
just
into the final.
Sorry to butt in, I'm just going to try and get a very quick word with Marco. Marco, fantastic ride, congratulations.
Yeah, I'm really happy. We did a great job yesterday with the team with Michelin, and Clinica Mobile make a good job on me, perfect. Today I felt so good, and I tried to be quiet all the race, and I tried to push the last five or six lap, I think. But Valentino bike was a little bit faster than mine on the straight, and when he passed me back again, I tried to do again, to overtake him again last lap, but I made a small mistake, but yeah, I want to win before the end of the season, but it would be so difficult.
Marco, thank you very much.
Thanks,
Marco Melandri wants to win before the end of the season. Almost did it here in Qatar. He's got three more chances. Phillip Island in 2 weeks. Then, of course, in Istanbul, in Turkey, our first visit there. And then the final round of the season on November the 6th at Valencia. So, well, after that performance, you certainly wouldn't rule it out. He pushed Valentino Rossi all the way here, Marco Melandri. And the stronger that foot gets towards the end of the season, the more likely he is to push him even harder. That was the move on the final lap. Did everything he could, stood it up onto the grass, and Rossi was clear to take the win. As I said, 1.6 seconds of winning margin for Rossi, but that definitely did not tell the whole story. I was just saying about Marco Melandri before that crash at Laguna Seca, really seemed to knock the stuffing out of him, and then a wet race at Donington Park, came back and got a disappointing 8th place in Germany, again 6th place in the Czech Republic, then he crashed out in Japan after that collision with Valentino Rossi, came back strongly to take 5th at Malaysia last week, but that was, I would say, Marco Melandri's best performance of the season, without a doubt.
Couldn't agree with you more. I'm just listening to, not that I can understand him, of course, Valentino Rossi, chat away, Italian, to the press at the moment. He is really, really pleased, I can tell you. It's a win for Valentino Rossi. I think perhaps in some ways it's an even bigger win for MotoGP and certainly for Qatar with all the money they put in and all the money they have invested in the championship. I wanted to speak to Valentino Rossi. He wanted to speak to me, but the gentleman in charge said he had to go and speak to somebody else.
There's too many people.
That's life, isn't it?
Too many people more important than you down there, Nick.
I think you probably got that right, Matt. But as long as you haven't eaten all the sandwiches, that's the main thing.
Don't worry, I'll look after you, if nobody else
will. Yeah, thank you. In fact, I think he was going to talk to Randy Mamola. So I think that's pretty fair, really. What, 13 Grand Prix wins, 4 times runner-up in the World Championship. We'll let him off with that one.
So the top speed at the Grand Prix of Qatar, Carlos Checa with 322 kilometres an hour on the Ducati. Robbie Rolfo, surprisingly, with 318.3 on the other Ducati. Last year's Ducati, of course, for Rolfo on those Dunlop tyres. And incidentally, Robbie Rolfo, who made that wonderful start to the race, he was up as high as 7th. He ended the race down in 12th.
He did well, didn't he? And as I said, I think in the race, he's just got to put himself in the shot window, hasn't he? That's all he can do, put himself in the shot window. And he really, really did exactly that.
Interesting to see there as well, Nick. Marco Melandri just saying to you that Valentino Rossi's bike was faster than him down the straight, when in fact it wasn't. Rossi with the 11th fastest top speed. So perhaps the throttle connection from the exit of that final turn was better on the MR. Maybe that's what Melandri was referring to, because as I said before, we've seen in the 125 and 250 races how they've been able to slipstream in the drag race to the line there. And Melandri obviously decided he wasn't going to have that opportunity, so went for an aggressive pass just a couple of corners earlier.
So in fact, the nearest Rossi's come to crashing this whole weekend was when he nearly fell over the board that's in Parc Fermé, that says it's the Grand Prix of Qatar. He was walking away, tripped over it and nearly went flying. That's the biggest problem he's had all weekend. Great weekend of MotoGP racing. Terrific performance by Marco Melandri and Nicky Hayden. Oh, Phillip Island, probably the best circuit of them all. It's 15 days' time. It is going to be sensational. I'm looking forward to going home for a couple of days. I'm really looking forward to the race. And Melandri, is he going to win a Grand Prix before the end of the season? I think he really, really fancies his chances.
Yeah, 3 rounds to go, as I said. Australia, Turkey and Valencia. And even if he doesn't win a race before the end of this season, Nick, you've got to say, next year, Marco Melandri, if he can keep it up and get a little extra support from Honda, he could be a serious threat to Valentino Rossi in the World Championship.
You've got to say, big result for Michelin as well. We were always praising Bridgestone tyres, aren't we? And always when Loris Caparossi's won those last 2 races. But they've certainly fought back in brilliant style, haven't they, Michelin? And really have dominated the race here. And the Bridgestones had a very, very tough time indeed. And Loris Caparossi starting in pole and absolutely nowhere at the end of the race.
Yeah, you're quite right, Nick. And I was reading some Michelin publicity earlier in the week, well, one of their brochures, and it said in there that when a dog bites a man, it's not news, but when a man bites a dog, then that's news. And they seem to feel...
That is absolutely perfect, isn't it? I felt a little bit guilty sometimes, to be honest with you. We're going on about Bridgestone. Are they doing that? Michelin have actually won so many world championships. And I suppose they've dominated for so long that, in fact, when something changes, it makes the news, doesn't it?
That's right. And as you rightly point out, Nick, with the way Michelin have performed today, Carlos Checa was the nearest Bridgestone rider. He was down in 6th place, 31.432 seconds down on the race winner Valentino Rossi. Michelin dominating the top 5 positions here, and dominating really was the word as well, so congratulations to them.
Been some weekend, hasn't it? Hey, it's been some tour, hasn't it? Three races in 2 weeks, different winners, different situations, world title, suspensions. We've seen everything in these last couple of weeks. Really has been fabulous.
Yeah, it's been quite an eventful 3 weeks, hasn't it, Nick? And as you said before, I think we're all looking forward to going home for a couple of days. But again, start getting itchy feet after a few days and start
Don't tell the wife, but you're so right, aren't you? You do. You get that itchy feet. And who could not be excited at being involved in a sport like this? Well done, Nicky Hayden, into third place. Back on the podium, of course, the man that won at Laguna Seca in America. He rode a really, really good race today, Nicky Hayden. Very steady and very, very difficult conditions, and a very justified position on the podium. But almost the man of the moment. He didn't win the race, but what a ride by Marco Malandri.
Rightly gets the congratulations from Nicky Hayden on the podium. But it's Valentino Rossi who becomes the first rider ever to win 10 races in a single season on a Yamaha. He steps up to the podium after a two-race drought by his standards. And Rossi celebrates his world championship with a victory at last.
We had troubles with the Australian national anthem, hearing it over there, over the wind just blowing it away over the desert. The Hungarian national anthem, that had absolutely no chance at all. But perhaps we might have a bit of singing, I think, perhaps, of the Italian national anthem. We know it well enough, don't we? But MotoGP was the winner today. That was a fabulous race. And as Jerry Burgess said, so good to see people like Nicky Hayden, Marco Malandri starting to really flourish in this sport at the top level. They're the future of the sport. Valentino Rossi, well, we don't know where he's going in 2007. It could be with Ferrari. It could be on an 800cc Yamaha. It could be to Ibiza, never to be seen again. But his impact on the sport, wherever he goes, will never, ever be forgotten. Now, the only race he's got to win now is Laguna Seca in America next year, because that's just the only circuit left on the calendar, apart from Turkey, where we haven't been to yet, that he hasn't won a Grand Prix race. He'd be motivated as ever to win at Laguna.
And if he does step aside in the future, then the man to his right will be one of the main candidates, and the man to his left as well, to step into his shoes as the MotoGP world champion. The present and the future have collided here at Qatar. Valentino Rossi back on top of the rostrum, winner of the Grand Prix of Qatar 1 year after that controversial crash. He's settled a score here with the LaSalle International Circuit, his 10th victory of the season, joined on the podium by Marco Malandri and Nicky Hayden. Davide Brivio up there as well for Gowaz Yamaha, who by my calculations are now the winners of the Teams World Championship as well. Repsol Honda in second place at the moment, but they will not catch Gowaz Yamaha over the final three rounds. Well, we might have had trouble here in the Hungarian national anthem and the Australian national anthem, but I think down there in Parc Fermé with you, Nick, there might be a few people willing to help out with the Italian national anthem.